Every nation has their controversial elections. The US has the 2016 election, the UK has the Brexit referendum, and Brazil has the election of the 2014 FIFA semi-final.
A night they're going to have, but they might have number seven here now. They have got seven. It's hammered in.
However, for Australia, it's hard to think any election could be more controversial than the 1975 election, with the government and opposition in permanent deadlock and time running out to pass a supply bill. Someone had to yield.
Well, may we say, God save the Queen. Because nothing will save the Governor-General.
By mid-October 1975, with the coalition in charge of the Senate, Liberal Party leader Malcolm Fraser would block the government's supply bill with hopes of forcing Prime Minister Gough Whitlam into another early election. When Whitlam refused to call one, Fraser and the coalition would turn their attention towards the newly appointed Governor-General, Sir John Kerr. As Governor-General, Kerr was expected to act on behalf of the Prime Minister. However, he did have the power to act independently, and technically only had to answer to the Queen. This gave Kerr the ability to refuse to sign bills into law, or even sack a sitting Prime Minister. Initially, Kerr attempted to get both Fraser and Whitlam to compromise, in which the coalition would pass supply, and in return Whitlam would call for a Senate election no earlier than May the next year. This was done to avoid the possibility of Labor gaining a temporary Senate majority, because the Labor replacement senators would take office before any of the other senators, if the election was to be held early. Whitlam, however, refused this offer, not wanting to compromise with Fraser, who he saw as threatening Australia for his own political gain. By late October, it looked like a breakthrough might be made when former South Australian Liberal Country League Premier Thomas Playford IV came out against the blocking of supply, causing several South Australian Coalition senators to waver their support of the blocking. Fraser was able to quell this unease, as well as gain the support of former Prime Minister Sir Robert Menzies, who issued a statement proclaiming Fraser's tactics as distasteful but necessary. Things got more heightened when Fraser requested that in the event of a half-Senate election, the Liberal state leaders should advise their governors not to issue writs, thus blocking any elections from taking place in those states. However, Fraser offered not to do this if Whitlam called a House election along with the half-Senate election. Whitlam again refused, however he did agree to meet with the opposition for a possible solution on Tuesday the 11th of November, Remembrance Day. This date was important as it was the last date to call an election before Christmas. Throughout this time, the Governor-General had been consulting with the Prime Minister and the opposition leader as well as other legal experts, and had to resolve the crisis. Eventually Kerr came to a conclusion that if the deadlock could not be resolved, an election would be required involving both houses, and if Whitlam refused to call it, Kerr would have to sack him as Prime Minister. Kerr kept this conclusion to himself, fearing that if Whitlam found out, the Queen would be asked to remove him from office. Eventually Remembrance Day would come, and Whitlam and Fraser would yet again try and solve the deadlock, and again would fail to come to a consensus. As a result, Whitlam informed Fraser that he would request Kerr to call a half-Senate election. Fraser warned Whitlam that without supply, Kerr would be unwilling to call an election. Whitlam ignored Fraser's warnings and would contact Kerr and meet with him later that day at 1 p.m. Kerr would later bring the time up to 12:45 p.m, however Whitlam did not find out about this change. Upon learning that Whitlam intended to call a Senate election without supply pass, Kerr contacted Fraser and asked to see him at 1 p.m. Whitlam would be delayed leaving Parliament House while Fraser left early and would arrive at the Governor's house before Whitlam. Fraser was taken into a side room where his car was moved, so it would be out of sight when Whitlam arrived just before 1 p.m. Whitlam would walk into Kerr's office and hand him a letter requesting the half-Senate election. Kerr would ignore this and instead hand Whitlam his own letter proclaiming the dismissal of Whitlam, effectively terminating his Prime Ministership on the spot. Whitlam stood in shock while Kerr proclaimed that they would both have to live with this, in which Whitlam replied, "You certainly will," and with that would storm out of the building. As soon as Whitlam left, Fraser was then invited into Kerr's office, and upon swearing to only use his powers to call an election for both houses, Fraser was sworn in as Prime Minister. The news was initially slow to spread, but by the late afternoon, everyone in Canberra had heard the news that the Prime Minister had been sacked. Around 5 p.m, Kerr's secretary David Smith would read the proclamation of Whitlam's dismissal on the steps of Parliament House to a furious crowd of ALP members and supporters, ending with the traditional words of "God save the Queen," which prompted Whitlam, standing close by, to respond with what is possibly the most famous speeches in Australian political history.
Well, may we say, God save the Queen. Because nothing will save the Governor-General. The proclamation which you have just heard read by the Governor-General's official secretary was countersigned Malcolm Fraser. who will undoubtedly go down in Australian history from Remembrance Day 1975 as Kerr's Kerr.
And with that, the election was set for the 13th of December 1975, and the campaign would be the most aggressive in Australian history. Labor would use the dismissal to generate outrage at Kerr and Fraser, and quickly Whitlam began drawing huge crowds at his rallies with people handing money to Whitlam to pay for his campaign. Meanwhile, the now Prime Minister Malcolm Fraser would run his campaign on the message of turn on the lights, portraying 3 years of Labor rule with 3 years of darkness. And the winner was Malcolm Fraser and the Coalition, with the largest landslide in Australian history, picking up 30 seats to hold 91. The Liberals had picked up so many seats that they didn't even need the Country Party, now called the National Country Party, to form a government. However, after 50 years of partnership, the two parties would continue the coalition. While Whitlam's campaign had initially gained a large amount of momentum from the sacking, by election day the nation's focus was on the economy, and with inflation and unemployment rising, Whitlam would be reduced to a mere 36 seats. Labor would lose nearly all their young upcoming members, holding only their safest seats. And so would end the Whitlam Labor government only 3 years after breaking their 21 years of election drought. The reasons for Whitlam's failures ranged from an inexperienced party who had not governed since World War II to a hostile economic environment with the energy crisis. However, despite its short tenure, Whitlam had revolutionised the nation and brought massive changes which some argued created the modern Australia, and forever cemented Whitlam as one of the nation's most important prime ministers. With Whitlam's majority gone, Kerr was able to keep his job as Governor-General. However, he would not last long, facing unrelenting attacks from the Labor Party and their supporters, who denounced his legitimacy and would hound him wherever he went. Kerr would resign in December of 1977. He would flee to the United Kingdom and would live out the rest of his life there. He would eventually pass away in 1991, at the age of 76. However, his death was kept secret to avoid the shame of being denied a state funeral by the then hawk Labor government. To some, the biggest loser of the 1975 constitutional crisis and subsequent election was not Whitlam and the Labor Party, but Kerr himself, whose distinguished career had been crushed and would live out the rest of his life in shame and exile. Meanwhile, as for Whitlam and Fraser, they would have one more go against each other, as I come back next time for the election of 1977.